This is the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour, interviews with writers on KPFA's nationally syndicated Bookwaves program, along with interviews about film and theater and archive book interviews that stretch back four decades. I'm your host, Richard Wolinsky. Today's program starts with an interview with Maureen Gosling, who collaborated for several years with documentary filmmaker Les Blank. Pacific Film Archive is running a retrospective on the work of Les Blank from June 7th through July 27th. Then we'll hear the concluding segment from a 2002 interview with the late novelist Paul Auster, who died on April 30th at the age of 77. Part 1 aired last week. Today's show concludes with a review of the play The Lehman Brothers Trilogy, which runs at ACT's Tony Rimby Theater through June 23rd. And of course, you can find live theater listings updated every week and links to bookstore event calendars and live theater venues by going to the kpfa.org webpage for today's program. My guest is Maureen Gosling, who is a filmmaker, film editor. She was the co-author, if you want to call it that, of the films, many of the films of Les Blank, best known for a film called Burden of Dreams about the making of the strange film Fitzcarraldo. But over the years, he was also a dynamic documentary filmmaker, died in 2013. There's a retrospective of the films of Les Blank at BAM PFA, Berkeley Art Museum, Pacific Film Archive, from June 7th to July 27th. And it will include many of the films. The films are also available right now on the Criterion app. Maureen Gosling has also been a filmmaker on her own. Among the films are This Ain't No Mouse Music, which is the story of Chris Strachwitz and Arhuli Records. And Chris Strachwitz was on KPFA for many years doing a show called Panhandle Country. Other films include Blossoms of Fire, which is about the people of Oaxaca in Mexico, A Skirt Full of Butterflies, Bamako Chic, which is in development, I believe.
It's actually finished now.
Maureen Gosling, let's start a little bit about how you got involved with all of these films. Before going into the films themselves, how did you meet Les Blank, and what was he doing when you met him?
I ended up getting a degree in social anthropology from the University of Michigan, but I had this love of film that developed from my first true love, that, you know, who I broke up with, but the love of film remained, even though he had introduced me to foreign films. So I was obsessed with going to movies, and I visited a film class of a friend of mine. A magazine was being passed. My eyes fell on this ad for an anthropological film festival at Temple University in Philadelphia. So I got my nerve up and went, and I met Les Blank at this film festival, and I just thought his films were so beautiful, so poetic, and so different. You know, they were very unusual. I got my nerve up to talk to him at a party briefly. Different things happened. He actually started writing back and forth to each other. And 9 months later, I flew to Hollywood. I felt like I jumped off a cliff because suddenly I was going to be a sound recordist. And I didn't realize that that's what my job was going to be.
Did you know anything about sound recording?
No, I knew nothing. And I just thought that I was going to be his little assistant, right? And he was just going to tell me what to do. I didn't know that I was going to actually have to carry a 25-pound Nagra tape recorder around and a shotgun mic and microphones and have to record music in dance halls. And I got a little bit of help from a friend of his before we went from Hollywood to Black French Louisiana. But it was kind of like once I was in that situation, no matter how difficult Les was at the time because he was going through some emotional difficulties, I just knew I couldn't turn back because the world that he opened up was just so amazing. And we were hanging out in Black French dance halls, Zydeco, you know, Clifton Chenier, hanging out with Cajuns and eating gumbo. And it just was this wonderful, wild world that I didn't know existed, you know. it went on from there. We were on our way back to Hollywood, and Les got a call from Denny Cordell, Leon Russell's producer, that they were interested in talking to Les about doing a film about Leon Russell, the rock star who was really quite well known at that point, especially for the Concert for Bangladesh and working with Joe Cocker. So we ended up in Northeast Oklahoma. Les saw the lake where Leon had his recording studio, and he said, "Hey, Leon, I'll do your film, but can you let me edit my Louisiana film at the same time?" Because he saw that lake, and he just wanted to swim and be in nature. And so our first place that we stayed was on this Pappy Reeves fishing dock. It was this little floating motel, and we each had a room, and then there was an editing room with Les's upright moviola that he got from Hollywood flown in. So we were living on the houseboat for a while before we got moved up to better quarters. And so we were able to do exactly what he wanted to do, which was edit what became Dry Wood and Hot Pepper and do the film about Leon.
A Poem is a Naked Person is the name of the film, and it's, I think, only one of three full-length documentary features that Les made over the years. Maybe you could correct me on that. But let's go back to Les himself. How did he get interested in film? Was he a Berkeley person? Because so much of his work is set in Berkeley, and particularly a lot of it, which is about food, is set at Chez Panisse, of all places. So let's go back. How did he get into film? And what year was it that you met him?
Well, he was from Tampa, Florida. And one of the things that I like to bring out that people don't really realize is he was an early, really acknowledged Southern filmmaker. And he had a sensibility that was unique because of that, I think. He grew up in a household that was, you know, we would regard as racist. And he started hanging out with Lightning Hopkins and black blues musicians and sort of was temporarily disowned by his family. But he got interested, I'm not sure specifically, I think he wanted to be a actual Hollywood filmmaker. You know, he wanted to do scripted films. So he tried writing scripts. There were lots of other things that he tried, and I can't remember all of them, but he ended up at Tulane University in New Orleans, and that's when he got exposed to the culture of New Orleans and then also Cajun culture out in the countryside. First, he did move to L.A. He did a lot of industrial films first. He wrote the narration, he shot it, he edited it, and, you know, it was for these companies, like chicken companies, and I can't remember them all, but Les Blank's son Herod has been rescuing all of Les's old industrial films. One of the things that he learned from doing those films was process. That's something that I really noticed in his films. When he filmed this woman making, grinding coffee and making coffee and serving it, you could totally follow every step, shot so beautifully. It really informed a lot of his filmmaking. He did a film about Dizzy Gillespie, the black and white film. Then he started working with this guy, Skip Gerson, who's actually going to be at some of the screenings coming up that Les's first early films, the one about Lightning Hopkins, Nance Lipscomb, and Cajuns, Spend It All. They started hanging out with these guys. Skip's father, I think, ended up loaning them some money to be able to shoot the film about Lightning Hopkins. Skip was really good at greasing the social niceties and being funny and hanging out with these guys, and they would play poker with Lightning, and Les realized, oh, I need to let the guy win because he was asking for money, and at a certain point they did give him some money. But that film he regarded as his most poetic and distinctively Les Blank expression.
And that came after the L.A. film, at least chronologically from what I saw.
Which L.A. film?
God Respects Us When We Work, But Loves Us When We Dance. And that's from the L.A. Love-In from 68.
the Lightnin' Hopkins film came a little bit later. What I notice about the Lightnin' Hopkins film is while the text, if you will, is about Hopkins and his music, the subtext, along with food, which we'll get into in a minute, but the subtext is the racism and poverty of the South, which comes across very clearly in that film.
Yes. I think the Lightning film actually came before the Love Inn, or they could have been around the same time because he was living in L.A. and then hanging out in Texas, so he could have been filming them pretty close together. But one of the things that I think is striking about the Lightning Hopkins film, why he regarded it as his emblematic film, is that he found his editing style based on feeling and emotion and connection and music. Anything that could help people connect to people and culture, because there's no reference to time. In other words, the civil rights movement was going on at the very same time as this film was shot. There's no reference to racism. There's no white people in the film. It's all about the culture there. Because it's based on emotion and connection, it has totally held up all these years. The only thing that you notice is the fashions of the people. But the emotions are as contemporary as anything. And I think that is one of the real contributions that Les made and tried to do in his other films that I appreciated and tried to do in my own films as well.
Maureen Gosling, the racism comes across in what they are saying about their lives. And
oh, yes.
You know, you see that in Dry Wood and Hot Pepper. It's a subtext that runs throughout those films, along
right.
with the music and the food and the poverty. I interviewed Paul Theroux, who's a travel writer, a few years back. He went through the South, and what he told me was that the poverty there, and so now we're talking after 2010, the poverty there was just as bad as any parts of Africa. So when I saw this film, I realized in some senses, even though this was the 70s, nothing had changed.
It's really true. I grew up partly in Appalachia, too, and saw white poverty, extreme white poverty, southern white poverty. But it's very clear with the people's surroundings and the poverty that they have. And that's the case also in Dry Wood and some of these other films. But I think what Les really found was the way that people survive this kind of thing through culture and music, and also trying to have a different take on those people who would be just dismissed because they're poor and would be dismissed because they maybe aren't as educated or whatever, but look at what they've got, and this is how they've managed to survive. And the music and the culture is a survival tool, as well as just giving people joy that they need with their hard lives.
Well, that becomes very clear, particularly in the detail he gives about the creation of food. In one of these films, we follow the living pig all the way down to people eating. The combination of food, dancing, and music just triumphs in these films, in these early films.
Yes, absolutely. And that, to me, gives them such an emotional complexity because you see the people in their environments and you also can share in the joy of their music and dancing and food. Yes.
So at what point did you start editing?
Okay, I started working with Les in 1972 as a sound recordist and an assistant. And then when we got to Oklahoma, I became an assistant editor as well as sound recordist. He ended up deciding to move to Berkeley. And so that would have been in the early 70s. When I worked with him again, I came out here to work on Chulas Fronteras that he did with Chris Strachwitz. I didn't start to edit till the late 70s. And by that time, he was starting to get tired of editing. So it was this actual wonderful transition where he would give me little tips along the way, and I was very well versed with his films and style by that point and really appreciated so much about it that any time I tried to edit, I tried to, you know, compliment that.
You're listening to an interview with Maureen Gosling, who's a filmmaker, and as an editor and sound person, she worked with the great late filmmaker Les Blank. Les Blank's films are being shown at BAM PFA, Berkeley Art Museum, Pacific Film Archive, June 7th to July 27th. You can get more information by going to bampfa.org. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves, Artwaves Hour. These documentaries, in fact, all of them that I saw, at least with the single exception of Burden of Dreams, but all of them are primarily collage, which kind of limits the length. You don't want something much more than 45 minutes. But that requires an enormous amount of film and an enormous amount of work putting the film together. So for you, Maureen Gosling, how did that work?
In those days, we were shooting 16 millimeter. That's 11 minutes for one roll of film. You had to keep changing the rolls. So we didn't shoot a lot. And the key was whoever was filming, in this case Les Blank, they had to have a good eye. And Les was careful in what he shot. He could be spontaneous, of course, but he knew what to look for. What he told me early on was the golden moments. And I always loved that because I understood what he meant. He was looking for the emotional expression of people just without saying a word. You could observe people's behavior and understand so much. So he edited in the camera a lot. A Well-Spent Life about the songster Mance Lipscomb was 4-to-1 ratio. Unheard of these days. And that was a 40-minute film. Part of it was that Mance was such an incredible storyteller and so full of philosophy that so much of what he said was worth keeping. Usually the ratio was maybe 15-to-1, 20-to-1 at the most. I think Burden of Dreams might have been 40-to-1. But the other thing is that when Les was turned on, he would shoot really well. You could totally tell. As an editor, I knew when he wasn't turned on because it was lazy. The filming was lazy and, you know, maybe he didn't care about the lighting as much or, you know, he shot too much stuff and it really was not that interesting. The joy was when he was turned on, and that happened a lot with Burden of Dreams. That was both. We had to tell a story, a specific story, more so than some of the other films, which were more sort of, as you say, collages.
Burden of Dreams also had narration, and most of these films did not have a narration. They would go from place to place to place. I mean, it was specific. You could follow it, but there was minimal, I can't say no narration. Occasionally there'd be a card. But there was basically no narration, which means that if you were going to do it, either you would have to create an invisible narration in your head, or it would already be in Les's head. Is that right?
Yeah. Well, I loved it myself. I mean, one of the first, besides Burden of Dreams, which was one of the first films I edited from scratch, almost at the same time I edited Sprout Wings and Fly, which I don't think is in the program, but that one, it's always finding the story in the footage. In other words, the one thing about 16 millimeter and the limitations of an 11 minute roll meant that there was a limited amount of footage, and sometimes you couldn't just shoot everything you wanted, and sometimes you missed stuff that you regretted. And so it meant that you were stuck with the footage you had. And so the story, it's like hunting for the story in the footage. But in, with Burden of Dreams, we knew we needed a narrator at a certain point, and Les was really reluctant about it. But I thought that we should there should be a woman narrator because the film was so male, so sort of macho story. And I just thought it would be a really nice balance to have a female narrator. And Les just said, oh, I have this friend in L.A. who's an actress. Maybe she can do it. And so we got Candace Laughlin, and she did a great job.
Maureen Gosling, one other aspect which we have to incorporate in this is the way sound works. Now, in those days, you had a recordist doing sound, and then you had silent film, which means you had to sync up both of them, which basically made twice as much editing in a way.
Yeah, because the first part of the process, well, first of all, you had to get a slate. Les had to film me either hitting my hands together, or we had this thing called a bloop light, that the light would shine for a moment at the same moment that it was placing a beep on the tape. And so my job back in the editing room was to transfer all the quarter-inch tapes to 16-millimeter magnetic film, which was the same size as the 16-millimeter film, so they could be matched up frame to frame. But I had to find the sync mark for each scene. And sometimes we didn't have a slate, and so it would require either looking at B's and P's, because you could tell when that was kind of like a percussive moment that you could assign. You know, first you had to sort of read the lips of the person to figure out what they were saying. Or you would notice in the background somebody closed the door and say, I've got a sync mark.
So how long did it take? Okay, so these films were 30, 40 minutes. And in fact, in the BAM PFA program, you put together, you know, two or three, whatever number for a particular program because they were short films. How long did each of the films take to edit then?
I calculated, this has changed because of all the footage that people shoot now, thousands of hours. I calculated at one point that it was like 1 month per 10 minutes for the editing, and probably a little bit longer than that. That was kind of a rough estimate. You know, so the Tommy Gerald film was 30 minutes, so it was 3 months.
Did you have a kind of B-rolls that you were able to just add?
Oh, yeah. Les was really good at that. Because he had been an editor himself and had been an editor, he knew that coverage was extremely important. And he didn't want to just have talking heads. He didn't like talking heads at all. He tried to avoid talking heads. So he was much more interested in, you know, spontaneous things happening between people, sort of like what we would call cinema verite. And he loved to gather images that would express where we were, where the film was taking place. So in Louisiana, we would just go out one day and roam the countryside, and he would film. You know, there was one scene where I had to go out in the marsh and yell to get this giant flock of beautiful white pelicans to fly up so he could film them flying around in hot. That became a beautiful scene in Hot Pepper.
How did he meet Chris Strachwitz?
I believe they met in L.A. at the Ash Grove, which was this wonderful coffee house that had this incredible array of music, from rock musicians to folk musicians to gospel singers to Appalachian players. I mean, it was a fantastic club. So, and then at a certain point, Chris told Les how much he loved his films, about especially the one about Mance Lipscomb, and asked him to do a film about Texas-Mexican border music, which became Chulas Fronteras. But I think Les definitely knew about Chris's involvement with Mance Lipscomb, Lightning Hopkins, and Cajun music. I think it was more of a compatibility that they found. I don't necessarily think that Chris introduced Les to those musicians, but he, I believe, has a credit for consulting on some of the films. And he probably, I think he might have provided some of the recordings on some of the films that less used.
I also noticed that the address given for the production company was Down Home Music in El Cerrito.
Chris's film company was called Brazos Films. The address of Down Home Music, the record store, which still exists right now, fantastic place. And when they shot Chulas Fronteras in South Texas, Chris wanted him to edit in Berkeley. So he'd bought a building with proceeds from royalties he got from Country Joe McDonald's Fixin' to Die Rag, but that became famous with Woodstock. He opened a record store, and he had Arhuli Records in this building, and upstairs was Flower Films, where Les set up his editing room. So I came out from, I was living in Texas at the time, and I came out to be the Les' assistant on that. So that's how I ended up here. And then Chris and Les kept this symbiotic relationship going by this film. And then later, Chris loved Chulas so much that he wanted Les to do the same thing with Cajun and Zydeco music. A lot of the musicians Chris knew and had recorded.
Werner Herzog, the sense I got was that Tom Luddy somehow played a role in that, and that eating the shoe for Earl Morris's film, that was how Les and Werner Herzog came together. Is that right?
Well, they had come together before that, but yes, through Tom Luddy, who was running the Pacific Film Archive at that point, and was often bringing in directors, including Werner Herzog. And Werner saw Les's films, Les saw Werner's films, and they liked each other's work. And Tom had to introduce them. He just thought that they would like each other. And sure enough, they did. And I just was rereading, there's a book called The Burden of Dreams book, and that includes Les's journal, my journal, some writings from Herzog and Michael Goodwin, who was with us at one point, journalist. And apparently Les and I had a dinner, went to dinner with Werner in Telluride, and that's when Les brought up the idea of making a film about Werner making a film, which was in the Peruvian Amazon, which eventually became Fitzcarraldo.
And that film, of course, is pretty much Les's mainstream legacy, because it turns out that Fitzcarraldo, who was kind of an obsessive explorer who wanted to create an opera house and bring Enrico Caruso to the middle of the Amazon, parallels Werner Herzog's creation of the film, in which he wants to take a boat and take it over a mountain in the middle of the Peruvian jungle.
That film, Les Blank's son Herod Blank has been doing everything he can in his power to preserve Les's legacy, which includes re-scanning or digitizing a lot of the films from their original components, negatives, and so forth, and then getting rid of dust and dirt and doing color correction, and in the case of Burden of Dreams, a new soundtrack even. And that film is going to show in the end of July.
You're listening to an interview with Maureen Gosling, who's a filmmaker, and as an editor and sound person, she worked with the great late filmmaker Les Blank. Les Blank's films are being shown at BAM PFA, Berkeley Art Museum, Pacific Film Archive, June 7th to July 27th. You can get more information by going to bampfa.org. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves, Artwaves Hour. There's sequences of Herzog just going off the rails talking. When you were filming that, what was going on through your mind? Because at some points he comes across as completely bonkers.
Well, have to give credit to journalist Michael Goodwin for bringing that out in him. He was having a Michael was our assistant for a little while down there, and he was writing an article at the same time, which Herzog wasn't that happy about, but because they didn't want journalists. But Michael was talking to Werner, and Werner made some comment about the stars in the sky are just a mess. And he decided he better ask Werner this question at some point. It was like, you know, Hamlet's soliloquy. And especially when I was editing, it was like, oh my God, this is really something. It was hard not to... There were more things I could have added, of course, but it's pretty profound.
At the end, it's kind of weird because it's suddenly you're watching the boat and then suddenly, okay, it's 6 months later, which meant you guys had left.
Yeah, yeah. No, we couldn't stick around at a certain point, and because it was just taking forever. You know, our funds were running out and we didn't know how long this would take. And it wasn't that long after we left, actually, that they succeeded. But we missed it, and so the footage that's in the film is from Werner's film. The little bit that is in there is from his film.
There's also, at the very beginning, a weird scene involving Jason Robards and Mick Jagger, and that, of course, came from Werner.
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, it's probably the only footage from what he shot with Robards and Jagger that has been seen publicly because, you know, he had to kind of shelve all that footage. I think he shot like 40% of the film with those guys, and then they had to leave because Jason Robards got amoebic dysentery and his doctor didn't let him go back to the jungle, and Jagger had a tour coming up and he couldn't stay longer. So Werner was absolutely devastated by that.
Two of the films kind of go off in different directions. One of them is Garlic as Good as 10 Mothers, which is all about garlic, and the other is about gap teeth women. These are a little bit different than the others. What happened? Did he just become obsessed with these ideas?
Well, Les fell in love with garlic, and I mean, it became part of, it was his staple, and I fell in love with garlic after working with Les. I eat it every day in my omelets, you know, but he would have a clove with him in his pocket wherever he went to lunch. Anyway, I think he started getting interested when Alice Waters started having her Bastille Day, 14th of July garlic dinners. He filmed one, and then a year came around, and he said, oh, better film the other one. And so I think we filmed three in a row, and he started to get interested in the idea of garlic and this cultural phenomenon and all the different cuisines that use it and the cultures that were involved. And I just think that he thought that there was something great you could do with this topic. And then the same thing with gap-toothed women. He apparently, in his youth, was sort of fascinated by women who had gaps in their teeth, and especially after reading Chaucer in his English classes about the gut-toothed woman who supposedly was a little oversexed. And so he wondered, you know, about these gap-toothed women. Indeed, are they?
Well, it turns into a feminist tract, actually.
That was kind of a different angle than maybe Les was originally thinking, but there were three women involved in this production, and we said, Les, you can't just make this, you know, you got to do something different with this film. So Chris Simon, who worked with him for many years and was married to him for 20 years, and Susan Kell was this wonderful woman that worked with us, and she ended up auditioning all the gap-toothed women, and she kind of helped pick who we would have in the film. We got people to tell their stories about their gaps, but also about their lives, so that there's this wonderful array of everything from a belly dancer to to musicians to
Lauren Hutton
to moms to, you know, all different kinds of women, truck driver.
I noticed that the film series, ends. I think the last one was The Maestro, King of the Cowboy Artists. And after that, until I began looking around, it seemed that was the end of his career. But in fact, he went digital. At that point, Were you kind of moving away from him?
Yeah, I was sort of moving on, feeling like I wasn't moving up, shall we say. I couldn't move up anymore. And I mean, I loved, I usually got sucked back in because Les would come up with these great ideas. But he was also sort of winding down a little bit. But then he ended up working with Gina Lebrecht, who he did All in This Tea about David Hoffman, who has this incredible place in Marin and was a tea importer. And then a film about Ricky Leacock, the director, the wonderful documentary director.
How to Smell a Rose.
How to Smell a Rose, yes, yes. So these are Les's digital forays, and they're pretty wonderful, and they're showing as well.
Oh, they are?
Mm-hmm. Those two are showing. Mm-hmm.
He died in 2013. Cancer, was it?
Yeah. I guess it was the diagnosis, it was about a year. At a certain point, he was started chemo, like in the, it was like a spring when he got the diagnosis, and then it was kind of late when he started treatment, chemo, and then when he was taking the chemo, he said, I can't live like this, I can't live like this, and he just decided not to do chemo, and instead just live, have more quality of life. It was quite something. We were expecting that he would be gone by January, and he lasted till April. And he had a wonderful team around him taking care of him, including Chris Simon, his sons, Herod Blank and Beau, and Herod's girlfriend at the time, Alicia. And they just totally took care of him. Oh, and Susan Kell, a woman involved with Gaptooth Women. And Herod filmed a lot of the process and was determined to get Les telling as many stories as possible before he died. And anyway, it was quite something.
Has any of that surfaced?
Well, Herod's been trying to figure out what to do, how to deal with it.
And you, by that point, you had kind of moved on and you were creating your own work. Where does your work get shown now? I mean, the Chris Strachwitz film is finished, and some of these other films. I found listings for them on your website, MaureenGosling.com. Where do these get shown? Where can people see them?
This Ain't No Mouse Music is going to be on the Criterion Collection. The Barbara Dane film is my newest film, and it's just getting going. It's just getting started, and so it's at film festivals, and there's going to be the screening at the PFA on June 26th, East Bay screening. And we just signed with a Canadian distributor for that film, and we're looking for a U.S. distributor. And Blossoms of Fire has been out of distribution for such a long time, and I'm trying to get it back in.
You've been listening to an interview with Maureen Gosling, who will be introducing several of the films of Les Blank at BAM PFA, Berkeley Art Museum, Pacific Film Archive, June 7th to July 27th. You can get more information by going to bampfa.org. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves, Artwaves Hour.
Paul Auster, who died on April 30th, 2024, at the age of 77, was a world-renowned novelist, memoirist, and filmmaker. Last week, I aired part one of this interview, recorded October 2nd, 2002, while he was on tour for his novel, The Book of Illusions. Today, we hear the conclusion of that interview.
The Book of Illusions, Lulu on the Bridge, Timbuktu, all three of them seem to reflect back on a statement you made, which is, by the time you're in your 50s, you're haunted by ghosts. And all three works seem haunted by ghosts.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Meaning, just to clarify for the listeners, you get to a certain point in your life, and a lot of the people you've loved and a lot of the people who've loved you are no longer alive. And you find yourself walking around talking to dead people a good part of the time, at least I do, almost as much as to living people. And you reach that point where you know that there's a lot more time behind you than in front of you. you know, your body starts to break down too. It's rather distressing, but there's nothing to be done. And ideas about how we come to our end begin to preoccupy you more, I think, as you get older. It's only natural.
The way you deal with it in Timbuktu is you have it all through the eyes of a dog.
Yeah, that's a very strange book. I think it stands to the side of all my work. I tried very hard to do something completely different. So whereas most of my books have very complex plots and tangled stories, there's no plot whatsoever in this. It's just, I think the first half of the book takes place literally on the front steps of Edgar Allan Poe's house in Baltimore, with some memories brought in, but it's very static. It's almost like a dramatic piece. Poor Willie, my protagonist, is a broken-down, schizophrenic, homeless poet, and his dog, Mr. Bones, is his only friend, and Willie's dying. And it's a comic novel in, I think, the deepest sense. At the same time, I saw it as a novel about love, the love between these two beings. Because Mr. Bones, although he's a dog, he's really simply a character in a novel with four legs. He's not a dog. I mean, dogs don't think as lucidly as this creature does. But at the same time, I think that we often love each other as human beings with the same intensity that dogs love people. And I thought that this relationship was a way to express the purity of those kinds of passions in a very almost fairy tale like way. And it was very difficult to write the book, I have to say. I could only do it when I was in a certain frame of mind, a certain weirdly jangled up, inspired state. I mean, Willie's language is insane, and Mr. Bones' thinking is bizarre, to say the least. So I was working on other things, you know, the movies that we've been talking about, but it took me from first sentence to last 5 years to write Timbuktu, which is, you know, quite amazing because the book is only 180 pages.
The book is also very much this monologue, and to that degree it did remind me of some of the long monologues in the two movies, in Smoke and Blue in the Face.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I like to see people talk. People talk in the real world all the time. And rarely in movies do people ever get a chance to let go and really tell stories and really express themselves. It's all chop, 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 you know, cut, cut, cut.
Paul Auster, you have a career of several books and a lot of writing prior to getting involved in films. Timbuktu occurred while you were working on the films, and the Book of Illusions came after. When you look at Book of Illusions, and yes, it's about film, and you compare it to your early work, what is the influence, do you think, of that, of the filmmaking period on this particular book?
Probably a certain kind of technical knowledge, a certain kind of understanding about what goes into making a film. It's very hard to know this until you've actually done it. But I don't really think that filmmaking has affected my work as a novelist at all. It helped me to write the passages about the films in this book, but the rest of the prose is just like my prose has always been. But it's interesting that movies, which are so important in our culture, and everybody loves them, and all over the world, people have loved them for 100 years. We don't really teach children how to look at movies, do we? There are no courses, really, we teach our kids how to read and write, how to play music and listen to music, how to draw and paint. But really, nothing about how movies are made. And I think it should be part of the curriculum after 100 years, you know. 10-year-olds should know how a movie is put together.
So I knew a friend of mine who was very good at dissecting plots of books. And he once said, in talking to me about writing, he said, the best way to think about writing, and this comes right back to film, is to visualize it in your head as if it is a movie and then get it down on paper.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about that?
It doesn't quite work that way. I think it's about the language, you see. And the language is about music. and it's about sound. And so it's not just pictures. But the funny thing is, I think most people who have read a novel, for example, and they've liked this novel, and they go around thinking about it, the farther away they get from the actual experience of the reading, the more the book exists in their mind as a set of images. The words vanish, and we see our characters moving through some imaginary three-dimensional space, not quite like a movie, because that's flat, but in the world. And it's remarkable. I think studies should be done about this. I mean, how we remember words as opposed to how we remember images.
Well, one comment you made that's very interesting is you said films take place in the present, books kind of take place in the past.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're talking in a book, it's always I did, I was, she was, or, you know, actually more active verbs than that.
Yes.
But in the present, you're seeing it right there in front of you. And yet at the same time, when you think about both of them then, as you're suggesting, you kind of see them in the same past.
Yeah, yeah, it's true. At the same time, books can do things that movies can't. You know, think of a sentence like this. Every day for the past 15 years, I've woken up at 7 o'clock in the morning and gone down to the front stoop and picked up the newspaper. How can you do that in a movie? You could show a man doing it one day, but to show the repetition, you'd have to resort to rather silly tricks. So you are in the present. You want to see today, but you can't see the continuity of experience as well, whereas books can do that in the flick of a tense. It's very interesting.
Well, you can kind of create montage.
Yes, but that's clumsy. There are those tricks, but it's not terribly effective. What do we have? You know, dissolves, fade-outs, and then these tricks that we're talking about. And that's about it.
Paul Auster, The Book of Illusions. How important is it, a title like The Book of Illusions, to define what the book is?
It's impossible for me to begin writing a book before I have the title. I just think that, in a way, a title organizes and holds together all the material that the book will contain. And every work of art has to have a limit to it. You know, you circumscribe a universe, and that's the place in which the work takes place. You can't put everything in, you know. It has to be only what's appropriate to what you're doing. The title, for me, is the first act of definition of what the work is. So it's crucial, absolutely crucial. This title can be interpreted in many ways. It doesn't mean just one thing. Obviously, you've read the book, and you understand that there are multiple illusions in the book. It's not just a study of illusion either.
No, it's not. And in fact, it could be the book of allusions as well.
I guess so. But illusions is a nicer word.
An interesting parallel is between the film Lulu and this is the fact that if it wasn't for DVD, we would never have seen Pandora's Box. And if it wasn't for the one individual in this book, we would never have seen any of Hector Mann's films.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that would ever have occurred to you to think about, that kind of parallel?
No, it never occurred to me at all. I mean, a DVD is a mass-produced item,
right,
after all, and people can get it. Whereas here we're dealing with a very private story. Things are on the very edge of extinction. And Zimmer happens to get caught up in the story, but only at the very, very, very end. So I wouldn't want to stress the parallels too much.
The idea of destroying all of your work so that no one sees it. Obviously, we have, and you mentioned, many, many writers who do that, who have done that. J.D. Salinger, of course, is the most famous writer with a huge body of work which won't be released, or we assume is a huge body of work.
One imagines he's been writing, no? I would think so, in these quiet years.
Well, we don't know. I mean, Harper Lee wrote one novel.
That's
and
right.
The word is, perhaps she hasn't written anything else.
She, I don't think, has written anything else. Then there are those amazing cases of writer's block, like Dashiell Hammett, who had this burst of novel writing over about 3 or 4 years, and then he couldn't do it anymore. Last 30 years of his life, he was stuck. But destroying your work on purpose, this is very rare in the history of art. I mean, I can think of Gogol destroyed in a fit of madness the second part of Dead Souls. Kafka instructed Max Brod to destroy his unfinished novels, which Brod fortunately didn't do. I can't think of too many other cases.
I can think of a couple of movies where the movies were redone and all of the previous footage was tossed.
Was tossed, uh-huh.
You know, things like September by Woody Allen, like, uh-huh. Who cares?
Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, it was just part of the process of making that work.
Right.
But Charles Reznikoff, the great American poet, reported that his grandfather was a Yiddish poet in Russia, supposedly a very good poet. And when he died, Reznikoff's grandmother took her husband's work and threw it out. She thought maybe the Tsarist police would come knocking and they'd find incriminating material in these poems and she'd get arrested. So she destroyed her husband's entire work as a poet. And that's horrifying to contemplate.
Do you think then that would it be correct or would it be right, morally right, in a sense, for Winston Smith to write his entire diary knowing full well that no one would ever see it? I'm talking about in 1984.
Yes, I understand. No. Yeah, it's always worth it because every once in a while, you know, a message in a bottle does wash up on the shore somewhere and someone picks it up every once in a while. There's the case of Joseph Joubert, a French writer that I translated years ago, a late 18th, early 19th century writer who only wrote notebooks. And he never had any intention of publishing them at all. And after he died, his friend Chateaubriand published a selection, and little by little people started printing bigger and bigger selections until the entire thing was published in the 1930s. And he's a major writer, a great, great writer, and who had no intention of sharing his work with the rest of the world. So there are these bizarre stories. Think of that young writer about 20 years ago, John Kennedy O'Toole, Confederacy of Dunces. The poor guy couldn't find a publisher, and he went into a depression and killed himself. And it was his mother who found a publisher for the book after the son was dead. So Emily Dickinson published 3 poems in her lifetime. It's a strange history, you know, the history of art.
Van Gogh.
Yeah, that's
another
right.
One.
Exactly.
Another one.
Exactly.
You mentioned Chateaubriand and his book. I assume that's a real book.
Of course it's a real book, yes.
Is a major portion of Book of Illusions. It made me want to read the book.
It's one of the greatest autobiographies ever written. In French, the title is Mémoire d'outre-tombe, which means memories from beyond the grave. And it's something that Chateaubriand spent over 30 years writing. And it's an incredible piece of work. It's a classic in France. But in America, in England, we don't read it. And the last complete translation was done in 1901 or 1902. So it seemed perfectly plausible to me to have my character Zimmer be commissioned to do a new translation of this very important work, which resonates throughout the novel, as you know.
Paul Auster, you mentioned France. I interviewed David Levitt not that long ago, who informed me that while Paul Auster is a well-known writer in America, over in France, he's the biggest American writer of them all. Is that true?
My works do very well there. There's no question about it. It's funny how these novels have traveled. I mean, not just there, but all over the world. It astounds me. I can't figure it out, but it certainly doesn't make me unhappy.
You've been listening to the second of a two-part interview with the late novelist and filmmaker Paul Auster, who died on April 30th, at the age of 77. It was recorded October 2nd, 2002, while he was on a book tour for his novel, The Book of Illusions. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves, Artwaves Hour. Coming up now, the weekly Bookwaves, Artwaves Theater Review. In the final days of the George W. Bush administration, the stock market collapse due to the subprime lending scandal, along with other fraudulent financial products. Some banks and investment houses were too big to fail and were bailed out by the government. But Bear Stearns, Merrill Lynch, and the Lehman Brothers all went out of business, the first two bought by other banks, but Lehman bit the dust. By that point, though, Lehman Brothers was already a ghost of the successful bank it once was, now merely another large investment company hawking scam financial schemes. Bobby Lehman, the last of the family, had died over a quarter century earlier. The company was created back in 1850 by three young Jewish immigrants from Bavaria who originally set up a fabric shop in Montgomery, Alabama, and one thing led to another. It's their story and the story of the company they founded that lies at the heart of the utterly stunning and extraordinary play, The Lehman Trilogy, on a national tour directed by Sam Mendes, which runs at ACT's Tony Rembe Theater through June 23rd. The Lehman Trilogy is performed by three actors, portraying the original three brothers, and at the same time, every other character in the show. Think of it as stage narrative nonfiction, interspersing said narrative with dialogue and set pieces that might include movement, kind of non-musical songs, all inside a giant clear revolving cube fronting a cyclorama with changing images. If you're looking for the kind of catharsis that supposedly is central to live theater, you won't find it here. But what you will find is brilliant acting from Aaron Crone from the Broadway cast as Meyer Lehman and others, Howard W. Overshone as Emmanuel Lehman and others, and John Hefferman, who joined the cast when the original actor died suddenly a month ago, as Henry Lehman and others, plus live piano accompaniment by Rebecca Bruce. Three actors on stage for over 3.5 hours, never once breaking rhythm, never once slipping up. The Lehman Trilogy loses steam toward the end as the company drifts toward its eventual demise. But along the way, we get a crash course in 19th and 20th century capitalism, the rise of middlemen, stock exchanges and investment banks, and the attendant wars, failures, and crashes, along with the story of Jewish assimilation in America and how greed can destroy everything. It's can't-miss theater. The Lehman Trilogy by Stefano Massini, adapted by Ben Power and directed by Sam Mendes, plays at ACT's Tony Rembe Theater through June 23rd. For more information, you can go to act-sf.org. Until next week, I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour.
KPFA's 2024 election to seat members to represent you on the local station board has started. Renew your membership by making a minimum donation of $25 or completing 3 hours of eligible volunteer work by June 30th in order to be a candidate, nominate candidates, or vote. Visit elections.pacifica.org for more information or call 707-500-1910 to leave a voicemail for the election supervisor.
We're all horrified by the events happening in Gaza and Israel. This is a moment when KPFA is needed most because mainstream media's coverage of this war is not balanced and reliable. It's expensive for KPFA to continue our fair and equal coverage of this ongoing conflict, which includes broadcasting the voices of people on the ground and those speaking truth to power. If you value reliable, unfiltered news coverage, support your independent radio station today at kpfa.org. Thank you.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at KPFA.